You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
It's summer, it's travel season, and I'm not left out of the travel bug. Like everybody else, I'll be traveling out of the country this summer. My question, therefore, is, are women everywhere the same? And are we on the brink of a global awakening? Don't touch your remote. It's going to be hot on Inspired Success.
Get ready to find hope. Get ready to be inspired. Get ready to discover your full potential. Get ready for total success. From the Total Success Coach, Princess Bola Adelani.
This is Princess Bola Adelani, the Total Success Coach, welcoming you to Inspired Success, your monthly dose of inspiration power, the program that equips you with the power and inspiration for total success. That is success at work and in life. And yes, it is summer, it is travel season. And like I said in my opening, I'm not left out of this bug. I'm also traveling outside of the country. I'm going to the United Kingdom and some other parts of Europe this summer. And, you know, since my practice really kind of began to have global impact, I began to ask myself this question. Are women the same everywhere? And are we on the brink of a global women awakening? And I have in the studio with me today a phenomenal woman, very well traveled, an international consultant who consults with a lot of big governments, small governments, non-for-profits, for-profits. I mean, she's just phenomenal, very well traveled. She's traveled to 59 countries. I don't know how many continents, and she will be telling us that in a second. None other than Miss Yvonne Renee. It's Renee, your middle name, Davis.
Yes.
So welcome to Inspired Success. It's such a pleasure
to have you on the show. It's an honor to be here. Thank you so much, Princess.
My pleasure. Like I was saying in my opening, at the end of, well, no, I didn't tell them when, but at the end of 2012, my consulting practice kind of went international. And it started first with the Caribbean island of St. Martin. And for almost 6 months, I actually had a segment on the Sounds of St. Martin, a radio program,
wow,
a monthly radio program. And then last year, it was the UK that kind of opened up. And this summer, I'll be traveling to the United to the United Kingdom and some other parts, hopefully, of Europe, you know. But and so with this new opportunities, mm-hmm, and in relationships with women in other parts of the world, I began to observe that there was more that unite us rather than separate us. And that, women everywhere seem to be awakening. They seem to be rising. They seem to be coming into themselves, owning their own selves, their own voice, owning their destinies, and kind of just pioneering different things, taking the helm of affairs, whether it's be spiritually or in the marketplace, or even politically. And and that is what has led kind of to this conversation, to really better educate women on the Western Hemisphere, especially about what is going on in developing countries, you know, about womanhood and sisterhood. And I just know that there is no better person, better qualified to really kind of speak to that.
Thank you so much.
And to share, you know, from your wealth of experience what you've observed and what seems to be going on in the world. So tell the viewers a little bit more about, you know, what you do and, you know, how you, the countries you've been and the continents, you know, the seven continents. have you traveled to all?
Not to all.
Okay. So which one are you yet to, have you been to Asia, any of
Asia? Yes, okay. North America, not okay. South America.
Okay, not
I
South.
I haven't been
okay.
to South America
okay.
yet.
Okay, and what about Australia, New Zealand?
I haven't been there
okay.
yet.
Okay, so I guess that's about two of the five.
Well, yeah. Probably, is it Antarctica one? It's, we have the one up north.
Yeah.
So maybe four continents out of the seven.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, I've been to.
Okay, good. And so what has been your observation? Tell the viewers a bit more about your work first, your kind of work you've done. And
my company is a communications consulting firm. So I do work domestically and abroad.
Okay.
In the United States. And yes. And the work, it started out with events and public relations, and then it morphed into a lot of leadership training and development, negotiation skills, conflict resolution, public speaking, dealing with crisis, and then it morphed in more to strategic thinking, scenario planning, and what you do when you're in business is stay in business. You try to diversify your expertise, but it all comes back to communication.
Got it.
I got my first opportunity to go overseas when President Bush was in office in 2001. There was an Africa Growth and Opportunity Act to promote that was an Africa Trade Aid Conference or a trip.
Yes.
A congressional business delegation led by former Congressman J.C. Watts and some members of the Black Congressional Caucus that came with Fortune 500 companies like Microsoft, ExxonMobil, and Monsanto, but we'll get into that on another show.
Yeah.
But I went to six countries in Africa in 8 days, 2 weeks before 9/11, and it just changed my life.
Oh, wow. And wow. And so let's begin with the economically. I don't know whether specifically, you know, your outreaches and your programs target women in particular. And I don't know what kind of exposure that you've had with women in the marketplace internationally. But in as far as America is concerned, that is the emerging economic force. The statistics have proven since 9/11 that more and more and more women-owned enterprises are being launched every day, and that we're actually the fastest growing segment. So, but what is happening, you know, internationally, on the international landscape? What have you observed with really women rising and awakening in and starting pioneering business and things like that?
I'm a speaker for the U.S. Department of State, and I've literally spoken to probably several thousand women since 2001 on issues of empowerment, starting their own business, motivation, work-life balance, a number of issues that impact women.
Yes.
Some of them touch on the Millennium Development Goals as it relates to education and health of women, poverty, and so the like from all of those things involving leadership, I've been able to connect with women on those issues.
And so are you seeing more and more women rising, awakening to their destinies, you know,
well,
economically, starting pioneering?
I think the awakening for women has been in phases of time. It depends on what part of the world you're in.
Mm-hmm.
If you take the country of Japan, of which was the last country I went for the U.S. Department of State as a speaker before Ambassador Caroline Kennedy came to her post, Japan, unfortunately, ranks 105th in the world when it comes to women's rights, and you would think a highly developed country should not have that type of ranking.
Okay.
But women make 70... what would be equivalent of 70 cents on the dollar.
Yes.
They are not promoted in the workforce.
Yeah.
There's more than a glass ceiling. It's a cement ceiling that they can't get past. And it's very patriarchal and fraternal in terms of how men view women in the workforce. And the current prime minister is trying to change that just because he sees that the economy, Japan's economy has suffered so much, and Japan can no longer survive as a homogeneous society.
And so public policy in countries like that are not really favorable towards women. rising,
in this regard, it's not
sense,
well
economically.
In this regard, there's a real issue right
yes.
now, and because what you have is you have a lot of parity. Let's just use using Japan as a case in point example. You have a lot of parity between men and women getting in higher education. The women are highly educated, brilliant women, but when they graduate, they're not getting the jobs.
And so, what is the difference then with women, you know, overseas in countries like that? And women here, are you saying that, do you think that here there's more self-advocacy where people are advocating for themselves and even maybe more public, you know, kind of advocacy in terms of trying to change legislation and things like that, as opposed to, or are they still more, are they quieter? Because I'm observing, and maybe the countries that I'm looking at are a little bit more developed in that sense. Well, you know, in that sense, I'm looking at England, for example, where, you know, I'll be traveling, by the way, and I'll be at the Holiday Inn in Westfield Mall on August 8th. I'll be speaking to London's Movers and Shakers. So,
excellent.
Hey, you catch me up there, you know, on August 8th. But, you know, I guess, you know, I'm looking at it from that perspective, and I see a huge, when I say huge, I mean huge, phenomenal community of women over there who are really waking up and stepping up and pioneering non-for-profits and for-profits, different kind of enterprises. And but they are stepping up and owning their own. But is that the same elsewhere? What is the attitude to the women overseas
and
other parts?
It depends. You have to look at culture by culture. Mm. United States, we have a more vocal society. When you look at the women's suffragette movement when
yes,
it started, to
yes.
the sort of the quote symbolic bra burning movement of the 60s
yes.
and the 70s, and the quote feminist movement. It that has evolved, and so advocacy and change and how to go about impacting change, really the United States, women in
we're
the United States
leading.
Really
we're
have
leading.
Are,
yes.
are leaders in this,
yes.
and it's a Western phenomenon.
Yes.
However, women who are from the eastern part of the world may desire the same results, but realize in their culture they have to change. That's why Japan's an interesting example, because this is a developed country that actually gives economic aid to the United States, does a lot of trade and investment, and this is a big problem. 105,
yes,
remember.
Yes,
and you
yes.
talk about countries like Pakistan, Iraq, Chad.
Yes.
These countries are listed as some of the worst countries when it comes to the rights
yes,
of women
rights.
In the big case of Malala.
Exactly. We're just going to come to that politically. But, you know, that then seemed to be, I guess, maybe, like you said, the cultural differences.
It's cultural. So
it
change
is.
Change has to take place in the context of that culture.
And but then the change has to begin with the women themselves. And what I hear you say is that in those cultures, women are still more kind of laid back in terms of pushing against that.
I don't know if it's laid back as it is strategic in a different approach. I think culturally, Japanese women have been more laid back culturally as a people in terms of just sort of watching and waiting.
Yes.
But there are those. Mariko Bando, who's the president of Showa University. She
yes,
was the first
yes.
woman to ever be to sit in the parliament in Japan's history. She is not a shrinking violet. She's barely 5 feet. Okay.
Yes.
So she's the president of the university in Japan, in Tokyo, and in Boston. And so she's been an advocate, a voice for women's rights.
Women,
she
yes.
actually asked me to give the charge of leadership to the 25th anniversary for the Showa Institute just late last year.
Awesome.
So, or January of this year. So we can't just say that it's in the context of being just laid back, but there's a need to have some fire.
Yes, exactly. And that was what I was going to come to.
Yeah.
My next question is, are we on the brink of the, a global women's awakening? Or is it just little pockets here? You know, is it really going to take off and become like a global awakening, you know, where it's women everywhere, you know, one voice? Or am I wishful thinking here?
It's interesting you talk to a voice, you talk the verb, but voice. Yes. Voice is important to discuss when we talk about the rights or the position of women. But I would like to look at what Carol Gilligan says, feminist theorist Carol Gilligan says, in a different voice. So there are different voices coming up culturally that are unifying around similar and same causes. One of the ways to be able to see if society is really progressing is looking at the education and health of the women and then their employment and opportunities. That's how you judge it. Mm. But the way in which the voices are different has to, I go back to, come in the cultural context.
Yes,
and also,
yes.
also in this regard, the belief system.
Yes,
yeah. Oh, for
yes.
You know, yes, so for example, yes. In Japan, it's the Shinto. In the Emirat, it's Islam.
So or now we have to come.
In Israel, it's Judaism.
Yes, it is. And now let's come to that. Let's really go there, because that's the other shift that I have observed. You know, from in the faith community, you know, the belief system for me is Christianity, and even in all most faiths community, I think I've always been. You know, I don't want to use that word, but I'm just going to say it as it is, oppressive towards women. And not granted equity, you know, of the genders in terms of opportunities to minister, to lead, you know, spiritually and all of that. Mm-hmm. But I've also observed a shift in that regard, where I'm seeing more and more, at least in the Christian faith community, which is predominantly still kind of Western and then of course Caribbean as well, you know, which is influenced, which was colonized by the West. But I'm also seeing more and more women rising, awakening, leading, pioneering, you know, taking up apostolic leadership, you know, where even in arenas where it was unheard of, like the Anglican diocese now, really women and all that. And so is that also the same from your travels? Like, I know you're very, you know, you have great connections in the Middle East, for example. Was that what you would say is going on there as well in other parts of the world?
If you would take the case of women who are Arab, they would look at their spiritual or their faith relationship as an inspiration for the work that they do for the cause of women and equality. They would look at it because women in Islam are very private in their belief system.
Yes.
They're not out in the streets proselytizing.
Yes.
But in terms of their belief system, they you know, they'll always say inshallah by will of God for what they do and use that as their personal power.
Okay, so it's a personal, it's personal. So we are not seeing the same kind of like, you know, I don't know whether they're female imams now or, you know.
I don't know of any. I don't know of any. I don't know. Maybe in the future, you never know what will happen in the future.
Yeah, so.
I just think that with religion, it's more of a, becomes more of a personal. I think the West tends to be more revolutionary and pushing the boundaries and making the changes.
Making
excitement for the potential that, Secretary Clinton could be the first woman president has done the shift in terms of the 18 million cracks that she put in the ceiling when she wasn't nominated when President Barack Obama ran the first time for president. But I think what you have is that energetic shift. But it's important to note that even within the cultural context globally, there's a cultural context here.
Yes,
the struggle for women, gender parity is different for women of color versus Caucasian women. Very different.
Oh, yes, it is different. It is. There are still, but I'm trying to find to see whether there are some common threads in the way women are beginning to, you know, advocate for themselves, and women are beginning to rise and pursue their own dreams and their own passion and break outside of the boxes and the stereotypes.
I think what women are deciding to do and are doing, because they're graduating now at higher rates from college, they are starting to command higher salaries and have more of this all the women independent Beyonce or the song, command their own lives. And so you see more of that in a generation of women, younger women, that are doing that. In terms of advocacy, what you see are certain women doing that, but not enough. In our age cohort, you're still seeing a lot of advocacy. The concern would be the Generation Y and the generation to come. Are they looking at advocacy and fighting for gender parity, the rights of women, equal pay, or you know, like the Lilly Ledbetters of the world? Are they looking for doing that, or are they now focused more on the sort of the economic aspect of getting what you need and what you want? And here's the other dilemma. Mm-hmm. Beyond the awakening, because it's there, there's that work-life balance struggle that women have, delaying getting married, not having children versus having children. What does that mean? In other cultures, it's expected of you in some developing cultures to get married, even when you're in college or not even in college.
Yes, and I think the culture has shifted much here in the West. And if you're just tuning in, by the way, this is Inspired Success. And Yvonne Davis is my guest. And you can go to our website. It's daviscommunications.com.
DavisWorldTraining.com.
DavisWorldTraining. I like that. .com. And go and read more about her. Phenomenal woman of, woman of God. And just very fiery and intelligent, as you can tell already. And our conversation today is about, you know, this global awakening that I believe I was sensing and that I think we're on the brink of. And, you know, with my upcoming trip to the UK, August 8th, the Holiday Inn, Westfield Mall, you know, meet me there. And
I'm getting on a plane.
And I'm also privileged to grace the cover of Women Empowering Women magazine, an online UK publication. And then, you know, you're aware of my work in the Caribbean island of St. Martin for a while. And so, you know, that was what led to the conversation. And like you've heard, Yvonne is just phenomenal, very well traveled, an expert in really international communications training and consulting. And so we've looked at women economically, and we've looked at countries like Japan, like you said, that, you know, some are still behind the curve. And you know, we've looked at spiritually. And I think that basically, you know, we are still leading. Well, that's what you're saying. We're still leading, you know, in America.
We've been very creative in our approaches. I mean, one of the reasons why I'm asked to go to different countries to talk to women's groups is to share our strategies, our ideas of what we do, and to the degree that they can embrace an approach. Like one time I was asked to go to Israel and the Palestinian territories, and I was in Palestine. I was working in Ramallah, and they wanted to have a social marketing campaign that dealt with abuse. So I took the skills of doing social marketing campaigns from here in the state of Connecticut and gave them an approach of how they can do that. And the message was, if you love your daughters, you wouldn't hurt your daughters.
Yes.
So there's a daughter everywhere.
But you know what I have observed? And we only have a few more minutes, by the way, and we are not out of words. So hit us up and join the conversation on Facebook. The Inspired Success page, and just post your comments and engage us, you know. I'd really like to hear from you, especially if you've ever traveled out of the country before or you're from a different country, a different part of the world. I'd really like to hear your opinion because, you know, but what I have found with my work, even locally, you know, being on the forefront of, you know, advocating for women for years and women empowerment, is that the resistance sometimes comes from within, from women.
Absolutely.
The resistance comes from women. Yeah. And sometimes I think we are our own worst enemies. And have you observed that? Because we have the same, I think we have the same desires, you know, in terms of for significance and for making a difference and just for living well and prosperity and just the same desires. But I find that sometimes there's a resistance coming from women towards that message of empowerment or giving them the tools or whatever because of the cultures and some of the beliefs. And so what do you say to that? Have you observed any kind of resistance, or do you think that they're very welcoming to this kind of message, you know, very liberating, freeing message?
If you're talking about vis-a-vis other women in the same culture, you're always going to have groups of women who compete or fight against each other or have competing causes or agendas. And we could call it catty, we could call it whatever we want. So that always exists. But the key is what kind of conversation can we find to find a common thread? Even like, for example, how I came to the show.
Yes.
You know, the recommendation by yes. Lorna Little. Yes. It was in your mind. She made it happen. That's an example of people in maybe yes. in different walks of life working together to empower. So hopefully this show is a message that would empower other women to do
absolutely.
The same. So the power of networking, I think the awakening for networking with women is very, very important, and very necessary, more and more. It's
absolutely.
Not a question.
And that is what I was wondering, to hoping to hear, that,
yes.
yeah, that more and more women are coming out together in these countries, you
in
know, and around
regard,
the world.
I think there
and
is.
Trying to find, you know, common ground and find a common voice.
Or
still coming back to that
it's
voice.
It's the language and narrative that women use. You say common ground, common voice. How do we build capacity amongst women working together?
Yes.
And
yes.
appreciating that we are in different voices, but we all want the same thing.
Yes, exactly. And do you think we, in 1 minute, that politically, that we are ready for the first female president in prime, look at Germany, look at England, Margaret
Angela
Thatcher,
Merkel.
And all of that. Come on, you know, I think we are. But what say you?
I believe the whole men and women. And here's the thing: we're ready.
Yes.
But we cannot advance the cause of women without men. I'll end it on that note.
Yes.
We need
yes.
men still
oh,
at the table with us.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. And this is what Bishop Jake said, and I love this quote of his. It's my favorite one. He said, "The uplifting of the woman does not necessarily mean the putting down of the man. It just means that we're uplifting them to be the same status where we are both equal and we see ourselves as partners and teams, as a team rather than rather be divided."
But men play
and
so, a strategic role.
Absolutely, and that's what he was trying to say, that, you know, it doesn't mean that as we advocate for women that it means that men are being put down. It just means we're coming to the table and recognizing that we together, you know, together as partners,
absolutely.
Are going to bring the global change that we all desire. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I know this has been fun.
Thank you so
Inspired
much.
Success is the show. Yvonne Renee Davis. And we didn't get to your physical transformation. This woman inspires me, you know. This time next year, I'll be looking, I think, just as good. And that in itself, you know, I congratulate
coach.
You on that.
Thank you so much.
You know, you really are very inspirational. DavisWallTraining.com.
Yes, or Twitter,
yes.
Telios, TELEOS, the number one.
Okay.
And then Facebook, Yvonne Renee Davis.
Exactly. And then just tag her on my Facebook page, Inspired Success Facebook, and just join the conversation.
Absolutely.
And just go to her website and see how you can tap into some of the, you know, very phenomenal programs and services that she has to offer, you know. And like I said, I'll be in the UK on August 8th at the Holiday Inn in mm-hmm. Westfield Mall. Mm-hmm. Very excited to see and looking forward to seeing all my UK pips, you know. And so just come on down for an evening. You're talking about networking, you know. It's open to men and women.
Absolutely.
And just come, let's share, let's network, and let's empower mm-hmm. for an evening of inspired success. And then, of course, royalproclamations.com is where you go to get more information. Right. It's been fun.
Thank you. The time just went like that. Thank you for gifting women and gifting us in the world with your presence and wisdom.
Thank you. My pleasure. Great honor and great privilege. And thank you for being on the show. I'm sure this will be the last of you on Inspired Success.
Thank you so much.
We still have so many other conversations to have. And this is Princess Bola, you know, reminding you to keep smiling, put a smile on your face. Life's too short, you know.
That's right.
Keep learning, keep believing, keep networking, and keep on keeping on. I look forward to seeing you next month, and you have a phenomenal summer, and looking forward to seeing you in London too, okay? Take care. God bless. Bye.